Good evening, everybody. My name is Anthony Tamburri, and I'm the Dean of the John D. Calandra Italian American Institute, and I want to welcome you to this extraordinary event. And first and foremost, I need to thank both Rich and Nancy for allowing us to do this. We're happy to do it. We're happy to say that we've done a sneak preview, pre-screening, whatever we want to call it, of a film that's going to appear in theaters in less than a month, or in a little bit more than a month. So as a few of you may know, we are big fans of Nancy Savoca's work. You can see behind Lucia Grillo, who's shooting right now, there's the poster of True Love, which I consider to be really, within the realm of Italian-American cinema at least, a historical film, because it was the first film, I think I can say this without exaggeration, that it was the first film that deals with Italian-Americans and has not 1 ounce of element of organized crime or reference to it. And that doesn't necessarily disqualify a movie, because I just showed, along with True Love, actually, I just showed in a six-week course in Italy, Dinner Rush. And if some of you know Dinner Rush, it's a movie, along with The Godfather, which are two other wonderful movies. But this one, I think, is unique for two reasons, in addition to what I think are wonderful aesthetics. And first, because it does not have 1 ounce of reference to organized crime. And number two, it's a film about Italian America told from the female perspective. And two of those things were sort of lacking within the history of Italian American cinema. So I've already told Nancy that 100 times, but I tell you again, con tanto di cappello for that alone. We sort of highlighted Nancy before when we did a film festival here. I actually was born in, it was born here, but we first did it in Pesaro for the 43rd annual Pesaro Film Festival, and it was wonderfully flattering for us to have been invited to organize it, and we did. We organized it in collaboration with some of the locals there, and then we did it again here in 2008. We may revive that and do it again. It's been about 3.5 years now, so I think maybe we should do another one and have not only what are now some of the classics. You're a classic now with True Love. It's a classic. So not only with some of the classics, but also with some of the younger generations. That's one of the things we do here. We have, among our public activities, we have what's called Documented Italians, which deals with documentaries about Italians outside of Italy, usually the diaspora, although we've dealt with other issues that deal with Italians in Italy, mostly with immigration and things of that sort. We'll continue to do that. So I'm going to give over the microphone to Nancy for a bit. She's going to just speak very briefly about the film. We're going to show the film, and then we're going to have a Q&A, and then you can all go out on the town. It's Saturday night. We're in Manhattan. So Nancy.
Tall, now I'm my height, I'm short. thank you so much for being here. Thank you, Anthony, for having us here. This is our good luck charm, to bring our movies to the Calandra Institute, because from here, you guys give us the good vibes, and then we can go out into the world. The movie opens on July 13th, and we'll talk about it a little bit after the movie. I love the Calandra Institute, and I think that if anyone here is not familiar with it, if you came here through other venues, you should really check out what they do as a cultural center, the way they promote things that Italians and Italian Americans are doing today, and making everything very relevant and fresh and new. And iItaly is a fantastic website that's also you really have to check out, because there's great video content on there. It's news, it's politics, and it's also culture and food. You have great food articles, which is like my favorite part. I'm just so happy to be a part of this thing. It feels like coming home to family to be here. So thank you so much for seeing our movie tonight. I won't tell you too much because you're going to see it, except that this was, you know, I always have to say the same thing. It's a labor of love. It's another labor of love. This was a movie we put together with a very small crew and a very short amount of time. We'll tell you more about it after. with some very, very special actors, and I hope you really enjoy it. I enjoy the movie, and thank you very much for being here. I know this movie is about family and how difficult it is to get along with your family, but tonight I have my family here, and I really want to introduce you because my sister and I are so close, and people say, oh, is this based on... No, it's not based on real life. And I have... do you mind standing up when I introduce you? Because my sister Martha's here. My brother-in-law, Vinny. My father, Calogero, stand up, please. My niece, Elisa. My nephew, Manish. And my nephew, Anthony. And Elisa's friend, Gina.
I'm sorry,
operating the cameras are my son Bobby and my new daughter-in-law Jessica. So it's a family affair, we're all here. And we're all talking to each other, right? So it's okay.
Let me ask, I know I read somewhere that somebody opened up a description of this film and referred to you as Queen of the Indies. Which I thought was a nice compliment, and then went on to talk about how little money you spend on this film. So, and the type of cameras and stuff that you used that was unique to this type of, yeah.
Yes.
So if you can speak to that.
Well, when we first started, I was Princess of the Indies, and yes. Now I've like gotten older, but actually I'll probably let, this is the producer of the movie, who is my partner in work and my partner in life and the father of my children. This is Richard Guay.
Yeah, this one, the queen doesn't spend very much money. This movie is as, this is what I guess is referred to as a micro budget. The budget for the film is about $190,000. That's including the music, which is about 45% of the budget. Yeah, we shot it in 12 days, largely in one location, with a crew of about...
We didn't have all the money all at the same time.
Oh, no, we never had that much money in one place.
We'd shoot a little bit, we would raise money. We would shoot a little, do one cut, raise money.
Yeah, but it was... it's as low budget as it can get, I think.
Yes, that's another thing, actually, people, it's interesting when you hear about a movie being very, very cheap and $30,000 or $50,000, what's interesting is to find out how much it costs when it's all finished, because once it gets into theaters, they spend money, which is what ended up happening with us. We started at $50,000.
Yeah, the goal was to spend $50,000 just through production.
Just to get it finished.
We wound up spending about close to $70,000.
And then once you're done with that, then in order to get it to a level where now we're going to be out in theaters, which is very unusual for these micro-budget movies. They usually end up, you know, on VOD and in Netflix and, you know, if they're lucky. But we're actually in movie theaters. And in order to get to that point, then if you've made a low-budget movie like this, is that then you just have to keep raising more money to get it technically to a point where it can be released in theaters. When anybody here who ends up going to see this in a theater is going to see the version that is a theatrical version, and the sound mix is very unique to theater and all that. All of this was spent
right.
Additional to what we originally thought. Right. So we were micro budget to begin with, just to get it to exist, and then once people started reacting to it and saying this is a possibility to go into a theater and they reacted positively, then our goal, you have to be optimistic and believe that you're going to get, you just start raising more money, right. More money, and eventually you return that. But it's a very interesting process.
Yeah. Let me, and in fact, that reminds me of your previous film and the fact that it didn't make distribution. This film is going right into theaters it's too bad because they made another movie that's entitled Dirt and it only played at festivals.
Showtime financed that. So played on Showtime.
We played. And we could not play it in theater. We had interest from theaters, but Showtime's
the difference
the contract.
The difference
didn't
is
allow it
the difference
to.
Is control.
Yeah.
We own this movie still.
We have control.
We raised the money to release it. We hired the distributor, the marketing people, the publicity people. We control every aspect of this film. Mm-hmm. The other film was financed by Showtime, and you know.
And therefore, they had the rights, and they yeah.
And to say no, we're not going to theaters or whatever. Mm-hmm. So
yeah.
It's really mm-hmm. very different situation. This is actually more freedom.
Mm-hmm.
It's
yes.
very interesting.
Good. I guess the first question is the idea of passing, mm-hmm. wanting to pass.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought that was wonderful. About halfway through, there's the line about her wanting to pass. And the whole issue of, I guess, drama in Italian families. I'm not going to ask anything personally, but in some ways, you're a later generation of that. The idea of drama in the family, et cetera, it seems like it might be a little bit sooner. So,
you mean that they're younger than what?
Yeah.
I guess it's
also working class.
I think it's class. I think it's working class. And I think, because I have friends whose families, if they're more middle class, then are more assimilated. And then that becomes a different. Then it just becomes a different identification. I think that, and I might be wrong because here we have a room full of people who can argue with me, so I'm excited to hear your response. But I sometimes wonder if when you're working class, you identify more with your ethnic culture and it's more immediate to you. And this idea of like, you know, my grandparents and my parents and me, it's very close to me. But when you start going out into the world, which is what that beautiful book, Blood of My Blood, talks about, which is, you know, when people, the biggest fear, I think, sometimes in an ethnic community is when your children go to college, because when they go to college, they become different. And they pull away from the family, or so it seems to be that way. And then you think you lose them in a way because their culture, suddenly the world is like bigger than the culture that you're raising them with. This warm family, tight family. Identification, and suddenly you get an education, and then you're like, oh, also being in New York, I mean, you can see so many different people. You're like, oh, people don't, not everybody does it the way we do it. There's people who do it like this, like that. So it sort of opens up your mind, but then it can be very threatening to your family. So I think maybe in a working class culture, that's felt more strongly, and I don't know if anybody agrees or disagrees with that.
Well, I did, at one point, I did think back. I thought to myself, these are the kids. These are the kids of true love.
yeah,
in
it's
some
all the
ways.
Same. It's, yeah. it's
yeah,
very
it's
similar.
Same.
It's very
right.
similar, yeah.
Why don't we open this up to you all, because you're here, and this is sort of a rare opportunity. And like I said, I would ask you to come up here to ask questions because it's just easier for us to make sure that we get this really documented and archived for those who are going to come 50 years later to study Nancy Savoca's cinema.
I love the movie.
Thank you.
It was very, very moving, and I'm half Italian. I understood all of that. I'm a filmmaker. I haven't finished a documentary yet, and when you mentioned before about selling out to a Showtime and doing it independently, what would you suggest for a first documentary? Actually, it's a documentary about my uncle, who was a World War II Medal of Honor recipient. And
well, he wasn't just a World War II. You could say
okay, Sergeant John Bassalone. Yes, you saw the. he was one of the characters in the Pacific. And so I'm still going back and forth on whether to totally do this on my own, so I can have my freedom, or go over and talk to HBO mm-hmm. because they put out the TV series.
You know, it's a very complicated question, and I'm saying that in a very good way. And I think you need to, first of all, HBO is a great place to be, and they do wonderful quality things, and so does Showtime. And we were very happy with what they did. When we talk about when you're working with a big corporation and a big company, you do give up some of your freedoms, but at the same time, what you gain access to is a big machine that will get it out to people. And when you're working independently, you have all the freedom, but you also have a smaller machine, and you have to figure out how to get it out to people. So it's kind of, you have to sort of weigh that and really think about what your goal is and how far, you know, what your thoughts are, and also listen, hear them in the meetings you have with them, maybe hear if their ideas sound like the same ideas you're having. And if you're in harmony, then it's a great place for you to be. And if their ideas of how to get it out there, which, again, I think HB, I've worked with them, and they're really wonderful. But it depends on the people, the particular executives you're talking to. You have to have a feeling of feeling right with them. It's your intuition, really.
Right.
Of seeing if that's the right place for your story. And if you're feeling for some reason that it might change in the hand with working with a big company like that, then you'll want to take care of it yourself.
I mean, but I think I think you get it as far as you can on your own.
Right. Yes, I have the.
I mean, you go as far as you can on your own, because that's going to define the story. There's less, you know, it's not a treatment. It's not a piece of paper. It's a movie.
Yes.
So it's easier to figure out if you're on the same page.
Okay, good. So I have a lot of footage already.
I mean, I think you try and get.
Yeah, that's
cut,
excellent.
Get a cut, what's known as a sizzle reel, or even for the first 20 minutes, you just try to get it as far along as you can.
Get the flavor of what you want.
Yeah. Right. I have a trailer.
Doesn't change.
Yeah.
And say, do you like this? Because this is what I want to do. And then see what the reaction is.
Good. What is the birth of your movie? How long did you work on this movie?
Actually, this one was quick.
Well, this one started on a bet, actually.
Oh, really?
Nancy and my other producing partner, Netta Armian, and the writer, Mary Tobler, were having coffee. I'll tell the story. They were just talking about, because we had another project together that we had continue to work on after seven years. We continue to try and get that going. And Netta just said, we need to make a movie. So use my apartment.
Yeah, she goes, I don't care what you shoot. Just shoot something
just
in my apartment.
Just shoot something in my apartment.
Just shoot in my apartment. So that's her apartment.
And so that was in March of 2010. And at that moment, I said, okay, we're going to start shooting November 1st, 2010. And they delivered a script in August, and we started shooting November 1st. So that was pretty good.
For a film, that's really, really pretty fast. Usually it's years.
Yeah.
Most of the films we've done have taken 5 years, 6 years, whatever, and this was like within a year.
How did you pick the actors? What made you choose? They were fabulous.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I was in love with all of them. Mm-hmm. Actually, we had a wonderful casting director named Sig DeMiguel, and Mira was definitely a top choice for this. And then he introduced me to Tammy Blanchard, who plays her sister, who's amazing. When he mentioned her name, I said, I don't think I know her. And then he said, well, look these movies up. And then I realized, oh, my gosh, I've seen her so many times. But she's a chameleon. Like, she was in The Good Shepherd that Robert De Niro directed. She played the deaf mute girl in that. She was in a movie called Bella, where she plays a pregnant waitress.
She played Judy Garland on a TV movie and won the Emmy for that.
She looked just like Judy Garland in that movie. She's a chameleon, so you don't know who she is. And then you see her, and then you realize, oh, my God, she is a star. She's a star that you're discovering and hopefully will be a star very soon. She's amazing.
You said how little you spent on the movie. How do you get the actors? I mean, these are not amateurs.
I mean, it's the quality.
Do they do it out of love?
Well, yeah, at a certain point. I mean, it's a quality of the script, and it's the quality of the script, it's the quality of the director, and it's knowing that it's real and it starts Tuesday, as opposed to everything else they get offered. Where it's like, well, you know, if you attach your name to this, then we can try to go get money for it, and you know, it might be 6 months or 2 years or down the road, which we do all the time. But this one was different in that we're starting.
You get a lot of people that want to be in indies.
Right. I mean, in fairness, we met Tammy through casting director. As soon as she signed on, we went to Mira, and she was signed on right away. Patty was just a phone call away because we'd worked with her before. Michael Rispoli, the same thing.
This film, I'm coming from Lincoln Center, where there's the Italian Film Festival going on, and I saw a movie called My Tomorrow by Marina Spada. And it's about a woman who's passing in a way, and has a very complicated relationship with her sister and her mother. So
yeah,
and a very interesting director talking to the audience. So very interesting afternoon to think about Italy and Italian heritage and the relationships across generations. What struck me there and strikes me here is the choice of the place. It may have been dictated by the low budget, but why Union Square? Mm-hmm. What does it bring symbolically, and why was it chosen?
Well, it was dictated by the fact that Netta lives right near Union Square. Like, she literally, when you see Mira, like, have her nervous breakdown, and then she walks two blocks, and she goes into, that's exactly where Netta's apartment is. However, I lived in L.A. for, we lived in L.A. for 3 years, and when we came back to New York, and we got to live in Manhattan, I was so happy that I saw people on the street and that people were talking to each other on the street, because in LA that doesn't happen because you got to get in your car to go everywhere, that I think I was just in love with New York and Union Square in particular. Like, I love because Union Square, because it's such a meeting place, like everything happens there, and if you haven't been to it lately, like their farmers market is, it's just like crazy busy all the time, and you can see all kinds of things happening. So it's like a circus, you know? You go there, it's like the circus. It's entertainment, and you could just sit and have a sandwich, you know? And I think that idea of, like, things happening in a, like, it's a little bit of a nutty place and anything can happen, just was very exciting.
You should also mention the inspiration for the opening, because when Netta said write a script, Nancy already had an
I had
the
a script that was inspired by Union Square. There was a... When I came back from New York, as I said, my daughter, Martina, accused me of being like a homeless woman, where I would walk around and I would talk to people on the street because I was so happy that I could talk to people on the street. And so I was like, you know, but I was out a lot, and I just walked all over Manhattan. And when you walk all over Manhattan, you realize a lot of people have a lot of drama on their cell phones. And because it's your cell phone, you don't think about the fact you're talking about something very personal, you know, and you kind of like yelling, like today even, like yelling personal things, like having angry arguments. We've all heard it, right? There's no like privacy because it's the cell phone. So I watched this woman have this, I walked behind her and, okay, I'm going to confess, I don't know where she is today. I stalked her a little bit. She didn't know I was, because she was really having an argument with this person, and then you hear one half the conversation, you realize, okay, it's a guy, and then you realize, oh no, he's gonna break up with her and she's not rich. She doesn't know what he's gonna say next, but I already knew. So I walked enough to sort of know where it was going, and then the rest went into my imagination, and I went home and just wrote almost like a monologue of a woman breaking up on the phone. And then I realized that I was ripping off an Italian movie, because there is a beautiful movie, three short stories with Anna Magnani, who's one of my favorite actresses, called Amore. And the first story of Amore is her on the phone, is Anna on the phone, called La Voce Umana. And she's on the phone breaking up with her lover, and you realize, you know, he's over it and she's not over it yet. And it's just a woman on the phone for whatever it is, half an hour. And you're just mesmerized because it's Anna Magnani. She's doing, like, she's giving you her whole life in those few minutes. And I just thought, I realized, I wrote the thing, and then I realized, oh my gosh, it's like the Anna Magnani movie. So I started watching that and thinking about that, and it all got messed up. And then from there, Mary Tobler, my co-writer, helped me say, I said, I don't know, just this woman, like, breaks up, and now I don't know what's going to happen. And she goes, okay, I'll take it. And I said, she's got to end up in this apartment that we have to shoot in. So I said, help me. And Mary took it from there.
For me, the Italians' warmth, the family, the Italian families that were so large. And maybe many times in movies, I would see the Italian family represented in that way. So in my mind, I began to think of all the positive, the things that did work. And your film this evening was so courageous because you showed the reality of human beings that were Italian, and they were not getting along. Some things were desperately falling apart. Do you think that you could do this film like this now, more true? Because historically, people are more open and ready to receive those flaws?
Hmm. Well, I think sometimes it does happen, especially in our country, because we have so many different immigrant groups, that we kind of put these groups in different categories, and we say, we'll say, you know, the Latins are, you know, they're like hot lovers and great dancers, and the Italians are about eating and big family and hugging each other. And then you kind of go through all the different categories, ethnic categories, and give them their thing and the things that they're good at. And I think it's you're definitely taking the positive of each group, but I think every, you know, positive has a side that's more complicated. And maybe, and again, it's a personal choice for me that when I make a movie, I'm very interested in the things that are not working, because it's almost like the difference between, I love a sad song over, I like a happy song, but there's something about a sad love song that just, I feel like, you know, they understand me. And I think when I pick a topic that's difficult and complicated, it's about helping people get through a more difficult time. Because when we're happy, really we don't need a lot of help. You know, we're just happy. But when we're not happy, I think it's so helpful to watch a story that might, in some way, even if we're not exactly those characters, if we understand those emotions, and you'll be surprised. I've been so amazed that the people have come up to me after this movie. We were in Texas. We were the closing film of the Austin Film Festival, and these big guys came up to us after the film, and they were like, you know, they were veterans, they were war veterans, and it was like a group of them, and they came up to us after the film with tears in their eyes, saying how moved they were by the movie. And it was interesting because they weren't Italian American, they weren't women, they weren't like, but they were moved. And I'm really happy when it sort of goes past the specifics of what we're doing and into like maybe somewhere they had a feeling, or maybe it wasn't even their mom they lost, but a friend or something, and they just connected. And that, to me, is the thing, is connection. The flaws, when you write a story about someone who's flawed, I'm looking to see if people will connect with a certain sadness or something we feel. I don't know. Yeah, something like that.
I was wondering if you could talk about when you were younger and first starting out with film, how you found a community of filmmakers to work with, because sometimes you have a friend that you're compatible working with, but the ideas are different, and how to find people on the same wavelength as you.
Well, I have to say the first community of filmmakers I found is going to surprise you, because it was my family. Because my sister Martha, can I say it? She's going to give me a French one. When she was a teenager, would sometimes say she went to a movie that she didn't go to. So, you know, to go out with friends, she would say, I'm going to a movie, and maybe she was going somewhere else. And she was a teen, I know, I'm gonna sort of say this quick.
Dad's
she was
here.
A teen, I know Dad's here. She was a teen, but this was a while ago. She was a teen, and I was like the baby, you know, I'm like 4 or 5 years old, and I was dragged along to dates and things because I had to, because I was supposed to accompany her, and she said she was going to the movies. And so what happened is she wasn't really going to the movies, and she would make up a great story that didn't exist. She's a wonderful storyteller. And so she would tell these stories of these movies that didn't exist, and she convinced me I had seen it, you know? And I loved the movies that she talked about, you know? So that, and also all the women in our family really like were wonderful storytellers. And when they, you know, if they were telling the story of somebody in our family or their girlfriend or something who something happened to, they would like become actors and they would reenact it. And maybe some of you folks here in the room understand what I'm saying. It's like they're wonderful actors in our families. And there's a great appreciation for telling a really good story so that it has like, you know, it's funny, and or in 1 minute you're laughing telling the story, the next minute you're crying telling the story, because it's very, very emotional and very, very dramatic. So I already grew up with that. I did not have to acquire any dramatic sense. I had it. Also, the fact that you and Tina, when you'd babysit for me, told me that I did fall to the ground like Anna Magnani in Open City. Like every time my mother went on a date with my father and they babysat for me, I would hurl myself to the ground and not let my mother leave. And I'd be like, you know, Francesco! I'd be like Anna Magnani, like on the ground. Like. So I was like that. So that was my early, and my brother also who loved film, and my father who loves movies and loved movies. And we would watch movies that were another thing about cinema being like not even about language but about pictures, because my parents watched movies from different countries, from languages they didn't even understand, without subtitles, and they knew what was happening. Or they'd watch American Hollywood films, and if they didn't ask me to translate them, which sometimes I had to translate them, they would understand what was going on, because film is so cinematic, it's so picture, it's so visual. So it was really exciting, I think, to me as a kid, to know that this was like, later I found out it's called an art form, but I didn't even know, it's just like a thing, it's these stories that everybody would get excited about. So then I became interested in doing them. And the community I found after my family, and playing, making, pretending to make movies with my brother as well, as I got older and I realized, I think I might want to try to do this for a living, then I went to Queens College, where I majored in communications and took some film courses, and then from there I went to NYU, and I did find the community to actually make the films. And I worked with many of my fellow students on my first feature.
Do you think it's necessary to go to film school to find that community of people? Or?
You know, I don't know if that's...
I don't think so anymore. I mean, everybody in this room has the capability of shooting video right now. So there's film everywhere, you know, YouTube. I don't know that there's a more organized place. I think that the film schools provide some sort of, you know, or format for that. But you don't have to go to film school. I mean, honestly, you never really had to go to film. John Sayles was a great writer, and he rented an editing machine, got the manual, and learned how to edit. So you never really had to. But I understand what you're saying. It's that community. But
today, I think you find the community easier in a way, because so many people, I mean, you look at YouTube and these short films that a lot of young people are doing. You do a short film, you put it up on YouTube. The people that you're working, I think there's a lot of filmmaking going on now, and I think it's really exciting to see how the young crowd's doing it.
And our daughter is doing this right now. She's about to direct her first music video, and just with friends, and she met a rap artist, and she looked at the videos he had and told them they were lousy. She's not opinionated at all, but she is now, you know, so she's directing this first video, and you're learning. It's no different from the question about the studio or the HBO or the Showtime. It's just your intuition. I mean, she's going through this where she's learning to work with this DP and this editor and this artist, and, you know, it's learning that collaborative process to see if they're all on the same page.
I have been teaching your work for a good 20 years, and tonight I saw this incredible, I don't know what, inside this film. It's going to have to see it a few more times, but I found the Argentinian, Italian influence. Mm. And you just said it, which really brought it out, which is this, you said you love sad songs that, mm-hmm. you know. Have you ever listened to tango music?
Oh my God.
It's there. Because what is tango? Tango is
the Latin blues.
But it's the facing of the feeling. It's not a hiding of the feeling. It's not like, you know, it's like a languorous blues. Yeah. And I saw that, and I thought about it, and I thought, well, there's the Argentinian influence we've all been looking for, and
that's,
it's probably always been there. But I saw that tonight. I just want to let you.
Oh my gosh, that's like, so this is like a tango.
Well, I've been studying tango for 6 months. Now
really?
I'm a baby. I'm not a professor of tango.
Oh.
But I have, and so.
How fun.
Well, it takes a lifetime to learn the tango, and I think it takes a lifetime to learn to make movies. And you are, every time I see one of your movies, I see you learn something new, and I really appreciate it.
Thank you so much for
Nancy, I'm going to ask you off that to talk about the last song and I don't know how many of you know Madeline Peru, but we have been fans of hers for life, and how you came to Madeline and that song.
Oh, my God. Okay, what happened with the movie was that... first of all, the ending of the movie is a little abrupt because we had a different ending. And when I saw the footage that we have, I realized that the movie really ended when the two sisters were looking at each other over their mother's video. Mm-hmm. And there was really no place to go after that, and I learned that in the editing room. I didn't know that before we shot it. I learned it. I kind of had a feeling when we were shooting it and I saw what was happening between these actresses, because I was I always have a very privileged place to be when we're shooting a movie. I'm always right next to the camera. So that, what you see is what I see, but I see it in person. So I was watching, we videotaped Patti LuPone. There's so many stories. That's a whole other story. We did Patti LuPone's scene in 45 minutes, which in a movie is nothing. It's like nothing, no time at all. And that included Mira Sorvino's children. Those are all her kids.
Yes, by the way, that's
you know, in the movie that she sort of, we try to make a point to say she doesn't have all these children. Her character doesn't. You know, we're saying the cousins, they're like the cousins. The baby is her baby. That's the only reason why a baby can go mama, mama, and cry. He wanted his mother, and we knew that was going to happen. We pulled him away from her right before the cameras rolled, and then he just went, and, you know, we tortured him a little bit. But my niece Elisa, who was my tortured baby in one of my student films at 6 months old, understands that I abuse children at a very young age. Even as a student filmmaker, I was doing it. She bears no scars whatsoever, right? Not too much. She doesn't talk to me anymore. But
you know, she hasn't done her major film yet.
That was when we saw what was happening between the actresses and the crying and the... They were actually watching that videotape for the first time. So we shot this with Patti LuPone with Mira. Mira actually shot the home movie with Patti LuPone. We were so method. She shot that home movie. And then we played it back for them to watch together in that scene, and they had never seen it before. So we rolled the cameras, and Tammy, who's so beautiful and wonderful and in character, just started crying. And then Mira saw Tammy crying, then she started crying, then the baby started crying. And everything started happening, and we're there, Lisa Leone, who was shooting it, and I were there going, oh my God, oh my God, oh my God. And then I said, this might be the ending, and I have an ending I can't use. So that's one of the things you have to do in the editing room, is that make decisions like that it's a little clunky ending, but I don't have anywhere to go. That's my ending. That's it. That's where it ends. So when that happened, then I said, oh gosh, so people are watching this movie. How do they leave the theater? Because this is like kind of a heavy moment. And when we didn't have music, you know, you're working work in progress. You don't have music sometimes in a film. So we were showing these cuts, and we had that ending, that sad ending or whatever, emotional ending. And then the movie would end, and people would be like, oh, you know? Like, why did you just hit me in the face and let me sit here, you know? It was so horrible that Rich and I were going like, we need a song to bring people out, and we need a song to just transition you out of this situation. And Madeline Peru is an artist that we love. She's American, but she's French-American, and she sings these beautiful songs in French. She also sings beautiful blues songs, but they're all sad. Her voice is beautiful and bluesy and sad. And we went on her website, wrote a love letter and said, Rich wrote and said, you know, we have a movie. Would you consider doing meeting us to do a song for it? She saw the film, she loved the film, and she said, I'll record for you. And then we found this beautiful Warren Zevon song that he actually wrote when he was ill. And that song has just a beautiful meaning about, you know, keep me in your heart for a while is the name of the song. And so she recorded that, and, you know, makes me cry whenever I hear it. It's beautiful.
So where has the film traveled thus far?
It was in Toronto.
It was in
Toronto. It was in, and we're going back to Toronto, actually. There's another film festival up there in about 2 weeks. And Austin. I mean, that's been the festival run because we wanted to try and release it, you know, So it opens New York and L.A. on the 13th of July at the Angelica. Here in New York. Trailers are up and running, or they're supposed to be right now. And then
there's also a website, there's a website.
Yeah,
we
talked about having the studio machine or the HBO machine. You are our machine. and the postcard sort of gives you some details about what you can do. And believe it or not, just going and clicking on our website, just going and liking our Facebook page actually does help. It helps a lot. It helps create what are known as impressions. You can watch the trailer. You can find out all the theater dates.
And also you can start on the website now, these Q&As that we're having now, each one is a little bit different. People ask different questions. The reason why they're being videotaped now is that we actually pick a couple of questions from each one, and we put them up so that you can actually see and hear different things about how the movie was made.
Yeah, there's a whole bunch of questions.
Not just what we're talking about tonight, but from other
places. Yeah, there's a whole bunch of interesting things about the film that
about filmmaking ends up, you know, people ask questions about filmmaking, and we answer them.
So the film opens in New York and L.A., and it's also going to be in the Hamptons in July. Then it goes to about L.A. It's going to be at the Lemley, at the Music Hall in Beverly Hills. It's going to be at the Encino.
And Pasadena.
And in Pasadena. The card is not right. It's not going to be in Santa Monica. But
Again, the best thing to do is if you go on the website,
yeah,
it tells you everything.
Gives you
and it tells you new cities are coming up.
Right.
Because as they have interest with this new model that we're learning, as a city has interest, we get to see if we're able to release the movie
and
there.
And really important, the film is theatrical the 13th of July, but on the 15th of September, it's on VOD nationwide.
Video on demand.
And
right?
VOD is the new DVD for filmmakers. It's a very, very important piece, and we actually fought very hard to fit that because the theaters don't like. We could have played the Regal in Union Square.
Mm-hmm.
They loved the movie. But they didn't want to hear about VOD. They wanted us to push that out.
It's
push
very
it
competitive
back
with each other. It's very difficult
schedule.
Time
yeah.
for that because every if it's VOD, they compete with theaters. The theaters compete with VOD, and it's understandable because I think all of us. It's really great if it's possible for people to go see it on a big screen in a theater. I think it's a different experience than seeing it in your living room. I think it's not. Better or worse, but one thing is to see this with people you know. One thing is to sit in a room full of strangers and watch it. It's a different. You guys had that tonight. It's a different experience, and that's just another way to look at the movie.
So the VOD, and then it does go to actually. We ironically sold it to Showtime. and then DVD and Netflix come next year. It's also going to open in Canada. It'll be in theaters in Toronto, Montreal, and Vancouver.
And you might even see it on airlines.
Yes,
we're waiting in Canada. They're showing it on airlines and Air Canada, and then here they're waiting to see.
Yeah.
It's but now we know these things in a way that before when we sold it to a company, they did that stuff and no one ever told us anything.
Is this the first time you've done this from sort of?
It's the first time that we're really in control of.
Yes.
Well, I mean, like we're negotiating for a sale in Italy, France. Actually, there's a theatrical. Possibility. So mm-hmm. it's a lot of work. It's a lot of moving parts.
So we're learning. Challenging. We're learning all the time. It's like we're going to film school again too.
Yeah.
When she says she's from the Bronx, I couldn't figure out where she was from, but definitely not the Bronx.
Oh, okay.
Because her husband, what's her name?
Michael Rispoli.
Michael is from the Bronx. Uh-huh. That's the Bronx accent. That's an Italian-American from the Bronx. Once from the Bronx, born and raised in the Bronx, you never lose your accent. Al Pacino still has it.
Mira Sorvino asked me to record every word of the script so that she could do my voice. So she did my voice, and I'm from the Bronx. No, I'm just
and
saying.
And guess what?
I'm just
Mike
saying.
Doyle, the guy who plays Tammy's husband, where do you think he's from? Where do you think
wait,
he was born?
Tammy's husband.
Yeah.
Well, you say from the Bronx.
The runner, the guy, the boyfriend.
Yeah, he's
no,
from
no,
the
actually, don't say
the
anything.
The future husband, maybe,
future,
I don't know.
Actually, that's a contest question.
There you go.
That's a where do you think the actors from who played the, the sort of straight-laced?
Well, I gave it away.
Where, no, shush.
I mean, they
no,
could be from
wait,
anywhere, being
no,
an
no,
actor.
But begin, just guess, just throw it out as a guess.
Hello?
Because I cast him because he looked like Superman. He did look like a Superman to me. The wonderful all-American face, Half Italian from the Bronx. Very interesting.
By the way, where do we think Tammy Blanchard is from?
Israel,
no. Couple of guesses, no? Huh?
That's a good guess, actually.
That's a pretty good guess, yeah. Except that she's from South Jersey. She's from Bayonne. And still lives there.
I want to thank both Nancy and Rich for having immediately said yes when I had emailed them and asked about this. It's not every day you can do a pre-screening, sneak preview, whatever we want to call this, and have the people come also without any questions asked, just sure, I'll be there. And this is not the first time you guys have done it. It's, I think, maybe the third or fourth, something like that.
I think it's been a couple of times.
And so we've done it. We've done it in Italy, too.
I know. It's
we have. So maybe we'll have to do this in Italy.
I'd be thrilled.
All right. We'll work on it.
Thank you so much for coming.